Grant Napier, Sean Salisbury. It's just a good thing you can't hear what we talk about before we actually go on stream. How are you, buddy?
I'm doing good, man. How are you? Good to be with you.
Hey, good to be with you. Yesterday's a very depressing day because you realize there's no NFL football until September. Let's rehash the season. Let's rehash Sunday. Any aspect of the game that just surprised the hell out of you?
Surprised me? The way that Zach Taylor called the game late bothered me. I thought that he had a tendency to play not to win, play not to lose, as opposed to play to win. I thought he played it out of character for me, for him. Really, I don't think if he had to do it 50 more times that he would do it that way again. I don't. I mean, the third and one call, the fourth and one call. Hell, I didn't even like the second down call. I didn't like that Mixon wasn't on the field on third and fourth. It reminded me of when Pete Carroll left Reggie Bush on the sideline. See, my dogs are even going crazy. Reggie Bush on the sideline in the national title game with Lendell White in the backfield with Reggie Bush on the sidelines against the Texas Longhorns at the Rose Bowl for that national title game. So, for me, I didn't like those. I'm not shocked, but I thought that the Bengals would make adjustments, offensive line and protection purposes, in the middle of the third quarter and beyond. I didn't like the fact they got the turn. They had a chance to, I don't want to say put the game away, but put their foot on the throat when they scored the touchdown to open the third quarter and then pick the ball off and didn't go kick it, score a touchdown. They kicked a field goal. And, you know, I knew Cooper Kupp was going to do his. And I just, even if you're going to throw that last ball, Grant, on fourth and one, I didn't like the play design. Straight drop back. The pocket was caving. Get him on the move so he has three or four options on Burrow on the fourth and one call. I didn't think the situation was too big for him, and I never really felt like Cincinnati, other than a couple big plays, got into an offensive rhythm like I felt like they were taking over the game. Hell, if not for a couple big plays, it even might have been worse than that. And I couldn't have been more proud of Stafford, you know, to throw a couple picks and still to fight back. How can you not like that? And it proved one thing for the Rams that has been steadfast throughout. When they win, their stars dominate games.
Yeah.
Stafford, Donald, Cooper Kupp, Beckham had a good game. Jalen Ramsey had his troubles, but when you're facing Chase and some big plays, that's tough to do. So I wouldn't say shocked. I was a little bit shocked, even though they've been giving up a lot of sacks. Protection scheme and how piss poor it was late for Cincinnati, and their inability to – they looked a little timid with a buck 40 or so to go in the game, which has not been like them.
Your dogs, by the way, aren't – it has nothing to do with the fucking game and what you're talking about. It's that fucked up shirt that you're wearing. Your dogs, you don't know this, but they're Yankee fans. Thanks. And they're looking at your shit, and it's driving them crazy.
Let me tell you something, dude. I'll have you throwing away every fucking Yankee thing you've got.
You know what?
Okay.
You're not well.
Hey, why don't you guys spend more money and underachieve a little more, too? Could you guys do that the last couple years?
Let me tell you something. You know, when you even get to 5, let alone 27 championships, give me a fucking call, all right?
Well, you know what's great about that? Is no matter how much shit anybody talks about the Yankees, there's always that trump card that's, hey, man, great. You hanging 27 from the rafters, you dumb motherfucker. Yeah, no, you're right. Hey, okay, can we keep it within the last 2 decades? Maybe the last decade. hey, read this and weep, okay? CDSB, that makes for you're my bitch when it comes to baseball.
Hey,
yeah, my dogs be wearing a Red Sox hat. Right. I mean, I respect the Yankees. I ain't got no Yankee hat in the house, so I'll tell you that right now. And I love them, but I love and respect them. I love the rivalry. Because when I say I love them, you know damn well I'm full of shit when I say I love them. I don't love them, okay? I love the Red Sox, but I love the rivalry.
You know, you were talking about play calling. It's kind of similar to what we saw with Kyle Shanahan, you know, in that one sequence. I agree with you on the second down call. See, to me, in that situation, under 2 minutes, all you need to do is move the chains, and you can't take anything for granted. Second and one, you know, along the near sideline, you have Chase, and Ramsey's playing more than 10 yards off the line. That's pitch and catch, automatic first down. Keep the chains, give yourself extra downs. I think coaches have a tendency to get too greedy sometimes instead of taking what is there. And again, in that situation, you have one of the best kickers in football, a guy that's good for maybe 60 yards. First down should be the number one priority there, not trying to get a big play.
Yeah, and I think he was 14 of 14 in the postseason, Grant, I believe,
yes.
And a lot of long rangers. What bothered me, too, is And it chaps my ass. Is it? And like I said, hey, I was thinking from my living room, this isn't like hindsight shit. When they got the second down and didn't get it, the third and fourth down, I'm thinking, okay, I was already thinking about fourth down and one, what I would do. And we had a play we called sprint right flat in Minnesota. And every team has, they call it different, which gives you really a quick flat, another one over the top of the flat, a whip out on a bunch set, a whip out where the guy whips out and he's running with the quarterback on the movement. And then you got somebody over the top working the 15 yard where if you got to throw a Pat Mahomes before you take it, at least you got a shot, right? And we do that at the goal line or on third or fourth and one, but you're right on that second down call. See, to me in that situation, not only I play aggressive, but I play smart aggressive. And what happens when you get to fourth down on that, then it's desperation, right? It's like, oh, let's hope. I don't want to be in a hope situation. I want to secure the points. So give me the first down on second down. Then we got to buck 30 and two timeouts. We got plenty of time. And this team has seemed to, they know how to put their foot on your throat late. I mean, they you know, that feeling, had they go down and kick the field goal or scored, obviously the game's over. But if they kick the field goal, then all the pressure jumps right back on the Rams not to go three and out and give Burrow the ball back, right? So, and you feel real comfortable with your kicker, 58 yards or 55 yards, especially when it's covered and there's no weather in play. So I don't like a throwaway fade route, especially when it's a misread on a.
Put me in the shoes of Burrow there. You've been in those situations. So take me in the shoes of Burrow in that situation. You're looking at the defense and you see you got Chase, easy pitch and catch for a first down. Is that somewhat inexperienced? Is it the moment? Is it Burrow's personality who's always trying to go for that big play? What do you think's going through his mind? What do you think the read is there on that second
one? Yeah, he seems methodical. If I'm not mistaken, Grant, didn't I look up and see the chase had stopped and the ball was thrown down the field? Yeah, yeah. So, you know, I'm not even sure. And the off cover, I'm trying to figure out, because it's hard for me, and maybe we'll find out as we go along. I'm trying to figure out. And one of the questions I'd ask Joe if I was his buddy or would have been in there, I would ask him, I said, was that a misread? And we're all talking about third and fourth down. I'm thinking second down for a second here. If I got that big a cushion, the play is a hitch route or the quick, what we call a smoke screen. Catch and get it out to Chase. And in the open field, make the corner make a tackle. Even if it's after a two-yard gain, it's a first down, right? Because they had the big play on first down and a nice job. And if they were pressing, and here's the thing, if they pressed, I got to go back and watch this, and maybe they'll show it from – that's why I wish sometimes we had the All-22 camera on the network feed, I mean, you know, for us, because I really would have liked to seen what the pre-snap read for Burrow was, because just to take you through what we are and what we think is, if it's press man and you can't get over the top, a lot of teams, depending on what your adjustment is, when you've got two zone, which is two safeties over the top and zone, if it's called a hitch, which is a six-yard hitch route, right? We run automatic outside release, automatic fade. If it's too deep zone on a hitch, we don't throw hitch routes in pro football into rolled up corner because, well, you're throwing a hitch route into a corner who's standing there in the flat waiting to pick the ball off. It's stupid. So it's an automatic adjustment outside, automatic outside release up in the hole. But that ball, if you're going to throw it there, would be a rip shot before the safety gets there. So if it's too man or press, or let's say it's press bail. Right. If it's press bail, man, I get what I'm saying here so people know that, and you know this, but if the press man, and all of a sudden at pre-snap, it looks like press. So Burrow's thinking, even if there was a single high safety, so you got a chance to take a shot. If it's press, the first thing I think about is I'm throwing a fade for a touchdown right now, and he's going to go by. I'll take a shot on second down because your thought is I got two downs to get a yard. And if you're in the Super Bowl and you can't get a yard on two downs, as a quarterback being aggressive, you think we're horse shit anyway.
Right.
And they're not horse shit. So – but what happened is the receiver stops and the ball still went down the field. So I'm thinking, was it a misread?
But pre-snap, Chase is at the bottom of your screen as you're watching it on TV, and Ramsey is
To the quarterback's right,
and he's uncovered. Ramsey is literally 10 yards.
And going back, that hit should be built in. So if that's a play off coverage – and Joe misread it somehow, because in my book, and I'm not blaming it on him, but if it goes back and at the snap of the ball, like you said on second down, that corner's off 10 yards or more, and I can, you know, or 8 yards, 10 yards. Yeah. That if it's a hitch, adjust, you know, you have the option. Hitch adjust to a fade if it's press. Well, if he's off coverage and press bail, the receiver's job is to do just that, sit down.
Yep.
So maybe Joe misread it, and that's why the ball went down there instead of give me a six-yard hitch or an eight-yard stop route and give him the ball right now, let him do work. Yep. And so they missed it. So I don't mind a throwaway down on second 10 in the second quarter when it's 7-7. I don't have a problem with that. 7-3. Take your shot. Well, you saw him throw the deep ball. Ramsey got caught up, and he makes the big play to chase. But I'm trying to preserve points first. Then I'll waste downs late. It's like a pitcher. 0-2 in inning two with a 5-run lead. Throw an off-speed pitch, bounce it in the dirt. Who gives a shit, right? Yeah. But in the eighth or ninth inning, runner on second base with one out, I can't waste a pitch, because if I waste a pitch and put the other guy on, now you'll open a base, fine. Let's say there was no base open. Or you bounce it and you walk him and you're up two, and then the next guy gets to hit a 3-run blast. If you miss a pitch there, game's over. See, there's a time and a place for it, right? I don't like wasting downs in fourth quarter games in a Super Bowl that or misreads. Those have to be done, because I think we all take for granted, oh, third and one, fourth and one, this is easy. Well, when you're running Aaron Donald, ain't shit easy about it. I didn't like the play call, and it led to a fourth down desperation, and they pushed the pocket, and Burrow had no chance.
I didn't really think it was that well played of a game, to be honest with you.
Agreed. Agreed.
I really didn't. I think for a Super Bowl, it was sloppy. I thought you could really pick at both coaching staffs. I thought McVay's play calling in the second half was very suspect, staying with the run. You mentioned Cincinnati. You know, again, I don't know if that's just – you got to remember, this is the longest that the season's ever gone, you know, an extra game. I don't know if that factors into it. We saw a lot of injuries during the game, but I just didn't think it was that well played compared to what we had seen in the championship games and the four divisional games.
You know what's weird, Grant? It's so crazy you said that. I thought it was – listen, you look at the score and you think epic, right, 23-20. And listen, hell, it came down to the final drive. That's what we all hope for. But just the whole substance of the game – I did not think it was well played. I thought there was a lot of sloppy play. I thought there was missed opportunities. I thought there was, and we saw a couple big plays. But I'm with you, like the third quarter after the home run for the touchdown and then the pick, that, well, to me, that's where, even though it was in 3 points, that's where the tempo in the game of who's flexing their muscles the most, the Rams started to whoop that ass in the front seven, right, at the line. Because in truth, Cincinnati's offensive line, maybe not in the run game, but protecting the pass, they did a pretty decent job early.
Yep.
But the second half, Donald got a sack late, which forced him to kick a field goal on a drive in the first half. And then they went haywire with all the pressures in the second half, right? And I'm with you. Third quarter bored me, not that they care about what I think. And I'm like, okay, energy. Because after that first play to come out, I think, oh, we're in for one of those 31-point between the two teams mixed second halves.
Yep.
And it never really got momentum going. You know, even the Rams would go a couple three and outs and punt, you get a pick, before you know it, but they made the plays, the no look pass that Stafford threw to, I don't know if you've seen the end zone look.
Yeah, Grant. It was amazing. Amazing.
I always preach throwing a guy open in anticipation from the end zone for the fan that doesn't understand and sees, if I put a freeze frame on it, you'd say there is no fucking way that guy threw that ball there for a completion under that duress with that kind of pressure in a game.
Yeah.
Looks here, throws here. But it wasn't trying to be cute.
Right.
He worked and worked and worked him and kept him there and came back and knew exactly where Cup was, nowhere even near the window.
Right.
It's called throwing him open. And that was as good an anticipation under – we've seen Eli make great throws. We've seen Brady make great throws. That Mahomes, that belongs in that category. But I'm with you. I thought the game was there was energy missing, but I understand why. That's why I thought that they were going to play in the 20s. I didn't think it was a 30s game.
Why didn't you?
And so it was – I took the Bengals. I won the bet, but I just never it never got to the point where I was like – sitting on the edge of my seat other than the beginning.
Yep.
And when you open the third quarter and then on the fourth quarter drive, I'm getting nervous for both teams, you know, like what's going to happen here. But
right.
I think there was a lot of average football played, understandably so, in a game of that pressure. But I've seen better, I've seen worse, but it was okay.
All right, first series of the game, Cincinnati has the ball at midfield and they go for it. You know, if you look at the replay, Burrow made the wrong read there. He had Higgins absolutely wide open in the flat. Two guys went to chase, and that was a bad read for Burrow. Would have kept the drive going, and obviously the Rams get the ball in good field position. Boom, they go down. It's 7-0. I think if you get that first down, maybe you get at least 3 points on that drive. Not a lot of people are talking about that play. All the points add up during a game. That was a bad miss by Burrow there. He just completely misread that play.
Hell of a point. I opened my show this week with that very thing. I didn't like to open the game. And I know they say, oh, it's only the first quarter. Well, I know one play doesn't matter, but when you take that one, the second, third, and fourth down on the last drive, a drop ball somewhere else, a miss throw here, that's 6-8, like I always say, and they add up. And then they got points off it.
Yep.
They had points off that damn thing. As you mentioned, they go down and score through the Rams.
Short fields.
That's right. And you can't give good teams the short field. You just can't. Nope. Look at the difference. You gave the Bengals the short field in the third quarter. They kicked a field goal. You gave the Rams the short field in the first quarter. They scored a touchdown. What was the final score?
Yes.
23-20. 4-point swing. They had the 3-point victory. That's 4 points. Yep. I mean, if you look about it, and didn't hold them either to a field goal or just get the first down. And, Grant, there's a rule, and Tom Moore and Brian Billick, when we were in Minnesota, taught a great rule, and I've lived by it. And it was taught early, but people put it in different verbiage. And I tell quarterbacks this all the time. We always are anticipating making a more spectacular play, right? Make the spectacular play. Well, I can tell you this, that's I've talked to the simple play, and the simple play is important, and that was a simple read for Joe Burrow. Never pass up an open short guy to hope that there's that hope fact, to hope that there's a bigger play available to you. Mm-hmm. And quite frankly, running away when you've flanked the coverage, get it to him now in the first quarter. We'll tee the play up again later. And then you got a stationary route where the guy's sitting there where there's no movement, run away, and you throw it in, and your eyes are there. So what's the underneath guy do? Runs right to it. Because in zone coverage, what are they doing? They're going to run right to it. And if you free a guy up, once he clears that flat route, clears his whoever that guy is that's either covering him in man or who outflanks in zone, put your foot in the ground and throw it right there. Joe will go back and know that he missed a few in this game. He will. He wasn't as sharp as he normally is.
If you're the general manager of the Bengals and you look at Burrow's injury last year with the torn knee and you look at the beating that he took, particularly in the Tennessee game, the hits that he took in the Super Bowl, is that your number one concern going into the offseason that you've got to solidify that offensive line? I thought they did a really good job against Kansas City, but we're talking about a young quarterback in only a second year. You know better than anybody watching. You know what it's like to get hit. And you played in an era where you were allowed to actually hit the quarterback. But how big of a concern would that be for you going forward with Burrow?
Big. Carson Palmer told me on my show a couple days before the game, he's not concerned about Joe Burrow's ability and the Bengals on it, what he's done to change it. It's will they spend money? And will they shore it up? Or are they content? And people took it. I saw some stuff about, I think he said similar stuff on other shows at Radio Row, right, when he came on my show. And I think people took it as a knock on the Bengals. It's not a knock. It's called evidence. That's
called
been there.
It's
fact.
Right.
So now they got Burrow who comes in with a couple other guys but changes the culture in the building. They go 10-7 and they play they're just ballsy all through the playoffs and get their ass handed to them physically at the line of scrimmage in a handful of games and still find a way to come down to a 3-point game in a Super Bowl.
Yep.
Imagine if you take away half those sacks, even half the sacks in this game, 7 or 8 of them, and take half those sacks. That's one extra, two extra possessions, Grant. That may be the difference in the game for them. So whether it's protection calls, like on the fourth down call, 67. When I identify offensive linemen or defense, I always identify by the number. 67 let Aaron Donald run right by him. Just get a hand on him. Force him to go the long way. So, Burrow, one more split second, he may hit P. Ryan on that little comeback inside and get the first down, and they tee it up again. You never know when that chip block or, oh, I got beat. Hell, if you're going to get beat that bad, grab his ass, and we'll play another down. We'll move it back, but at least it'll be 4th and 11. I got a chance to get a first down, but he was just whiffed. You can't whiff on 4th and 1.
Can't.
But, yes, the investment part for me is two things. I still think they got to get better on the back end defensively. a defensive, you know, Eli Apple's an average player at best. He's just
best.
A guy.
At best.
At best. But you got to get better there. I think their defensive front seven's underrated, and you always want to upgrade with, you know, Hendricks, pass rushers, right? But the offensive line, if Burrow ever gets to the point where he's protected like Brady and Rodgers are,
he's going to be unstoppable. Right.
That they will be in position to win that division every year over the next decade because he's that good.
Did we just watch the greatest season in the history of the NFL by a wide receiver in Cooper Kupp? I mean, statistically, the answer to that question is yes. But what do your eyes tell you?
My eyes tell me that there's been more. You know, we look at guys that can jump higher and run faster. You know, but I don't know anybody that does all of it better. Here's a guy who he can set you up well enough that he doesn't have to run 4.3 to run by you. He looks fast in a uniform, right?
Yeah.
But he's quick. He cuts. And when they call a 12-yard route, they don't run it at 14. That dude will cut on a dime and leave you 9 cents change. And he was precise. So they're dynamic, right? And even he caught 8 balls. And quite frankly, Grant, there's times I'm like, and the worst thing the guy does all year long is miss a throw to Stafford out the on a little wheel route, you know, and QB special. But everything he does is done with – put it this way. The big picture over the year, let's add blocking to this too. He's as good a blocking wide receiver as there is in the league. He's committed to it. On that touchdown that Stafford threw, had to be one on the – was it the final – the one where he hit the back of the end zone where Cooper Kupp caught it running the pylon?
Yep.
When Eli Apple came up
right.
And he ran right by him, it wasn't that big a fake. Oh, you know why he did it? When Kupp came around, Kupp is so good at chipping and sealing off the edge that he freezes people for a second because he's such a dedicated, committed blocker. And all he got, and he knows this, freeze him for a second, hit the ground running full speed, run right by him, and it creates space. So, we look at Moss and Rice and the 16, 18 touchdown tech catches, but triple crown winner on a Super Bowl champion, and none of it's by accident. And he blocks, and he could catch 2 balls, and he doesn't give a shit.
Right.
Do you realize, I think, twice this year, once both of them were against the Arizona Cardinals, 5 catches that he had under 100. Other than that, he's averaging 90-plus yards, 8 catches a game, 7 catches. But they're not just catches that don't make a difference. They're catches that are clutch catches. My eye test tells me right now that you're going to have a hard time. And you know what? I'll bet you he'll be insane. I'll bet you if Stafford stays healthy next year that he will put up similar numbers. You know why, Grant? He doesn't take the simple routes for granted. You know what I'm saying? He operates outside the numbers when he needs to. He operates inside the numbers and hash marks too. He's not afraid to go take a hit. And his burst and his ability to just boom and cut and create separation for a guy that's not 4.2.
Yep.
So I don't know. There's been some great ones. Rice and Moss have had some great years, but I'll damn well tell you, you ain't gonna find better. You the triple crown. I've seen more spectacular catches, but as far as lining up and knowing what I'm gonna get every week and it's gonna be dominant, you'll be hard pressed to find a better season as a wide receiver in the past or in the future. It was phenomenal.
For those that don't know, you work in Houston. You're on the radio every day there, and during the game or right after the game, it was revealed that the lawsuit with Brian Flores has been amended to include the Houston Texans. And I had to read that twice because I couldn't fucking believe it. I just really could not believe it. And you and I talked about this last week. And I got to tell you, I don't think Brian Flores is looking good here. I really don't. I think this is a really bad look on the part of his legal team. And again, I say that not being an attorney, not understanding the legal system. But I that threw me for a loop. Was there much reaction in Houston over that?
A lot. I don't know if a lot of people in other stations and people are talking about it as a buzz. It bothered the shit out of me.
Me too.
And I'm one that's been supportive of Brian Flores' lawsuit. I get it. And it looks like Stephen Ross, don't play the I was just joking card on the 100,000. These are two separate things, right?
Yes, two separate things.
And you can compartmentalize. This is for this. This is for this. And you do the right thing, and I think Brian Flores with the lawsuit has the right thing in mind when he initially filed it by changing the way we interview minority candidates. Right. There's no doubt we need a change. But in the specifics of this Houston, Texas thing, to me, it looks like he's looking at Lovie Smith saying, dude, you're lucky I filed this, or you got no shot at being the coach. That bugs me. Whether he says it or not, his lawyers, you know, maybe lawyer talk, but they had to get it somewhere from somebody. Yep. And yeah, it bothers me because it diminishes Lovie Smith, who, quite frankly, over the course of his career, no offense to Brian Flores, last 2 years, is more qualified over the course of
Hey, if you put both resumes on a fucking table, if you put Brian Flores' resumes, no question.
Yes. Yeah, that's exactly right. So, and that doesn't mean Brian Flores isn't qualified. The problem is with all this talk, it diminishes how you feel about him, saying, dude, you're a good football coach. Let it go. Brian Flores thinking the only reason that he didn't get hired was because of a lawsuit tells me that he doesn't have a whole lot of respect, at least on the surface, at least it appears to me.
Right.
I'm not putting words in his mouth, to Lovie Smith, or his lawyers are full of shit with the way they spoke for him, if that's the case. I understand you're trying to get all the firepower. There was nothing. The Texans hired an African-American coach in Lovie Smith. The Texans had an African-American coach in David Culley. Now, whether people think they don't like the past history of the organization, I get all the dysfunction. I'm focusing on what they said, lawsuit, what? Hey, listen, I'm going to sue you. You guys didn't hire me. First of all, you do reserve the right to hire whoever the hell you want,
right.
Number one. You're allowed that in the world of business after you've gone through the proper protocol rules to hire somebody. Secondly, so is he suing the Saints for hiring Dennis Allen? Is he suing the Raiders for hiring Josh McDaniels?
Yep.
I mean, what's the Miami Dolphins who, oh, they turned around and hired somebody? Well, they fight. You're already suing them. So Brian Flores is everything. And I don't know. The Texans thing just seems like a –
I don't
reach.
Not only is it a reach, but I got to tell you something. If I'm an owner and I'm a GM, I'm crossing Brian Flores off my list now. I would never interview him because I would never want to be in that position. Houston, Texas.
You feel like if you order the wrong thing for breakfast, Flores is going to be pissed at you, right? If he's in your building, that, well, hold on, dude. We went through the whole protocol. We interviewed. We did everything. And we may not like the process of how they – Lovie Smith, I believe, if you thought Lovie was a candidate, he should have been up front getting interviewed, not as an – do I believe it looks from the Texas point that Lovie was an afterthought? Yes. I believe they made it look that way. But by no stretch of the imagination do I think they said, well, Brian Flores filed a lawsuit, so let's hire Lovie Smith. Now, there may have been some – hiring Josh McCown would have created a lot of – who wasn't, quite frankly, NFL head coach qualified yet. But to me, this whole thing, the Texans late with Brian Flores to interview him, feels like a slap in the face to Lovie. And then this lawyer's coming out and suing the Texans, saying, assuming that he's, oh, that was my job, lucky. Basically, it sounded to me like he's saying, his lawyers, that Lovie Smith is lucky I filed that lawsuit, or he had no shot at the job. That was mine.
Right.
It sounds so, I understand bitterness in some places, in Miami and what he did, but the Texans didn't hire you, dude. Every time somebody doesn't hire you, you're going to say, well, I was the number one candidate. No, some people don't think you're the number one candidate. The more you keep doing this, aside from the original good reason for the lawsuit and the way it should be, it looks like it's bitter beer face, man. Like, dude, go after the Dolphins. If you thought the Giants did it wrong, fine. But the Texans hired Lovie Smith. He's African-American. He's qualified for the job. Where's the lawsuit? Hey, you're not allowed to hire somebody else when I file law. And maybe they did hire Lovie Smith because they wanted Josh McCown originally and they got scared. And they hired Lovie Smith because they didn't want to touch you because the lawsuit. There's no law against that either, right?
Right.
Oh, we see it in players all the time. Well, he's got a bad – he did something we don't like. We're going to stay away from – well, we're not trading Watson yet. Why? Because they're worried about the legal.
Yep.
For different reasons. They're worried about the legal. So Watson can't get traded right now because teams are like, well, should we trade for him? Well, under that way, it's like, well, you trade for him anyway. You don't worry about – you know what I'm saying? It's just silly. Through all this, the main thing is Lovie Smith deserved more respect. Now, he got hired, one of 32 jobs. But just the process from Flores' guys and from the Texans making him an afterthought, Lovie Smith has, quite frankly, earned – more respect. Yep. So yeah, I thought Brian Flores on the Texans part of it. Yep. He may have hated the process, but it's frivolous to put the Texans in this lawsuit. Frivolous.
It's awful. And now, you know, you and I kind of touched on this. I don't want to belabor the point too much, but I wonder if the Deshaun Watson situation will be resolved before the draft. I just wonder if we'll know what the legal ramifications will be one way or the other and will the Texans be able to move him before draft day? What do you think? You think coming the NFL draft this spring, you think Watson will still be a member of the Texans? What's your gut feeling?
I know that's what they want.
Yeah.
If there some, you know how they do their due diligence. No, don't kid yourself. There's been teams who have sent research or people to do their due diligence behind the scenes, and they're finding out that are interested in Watson to send people here. I've been told this by a couple of insiders that sending people here to do their due diligence about Watson, even last year during the season, to find out, talk to people, where does this legal part stand, right? If, in fact, let's say all of a sudden, Grant, March 12th or March 20th, March 25th, they've done due diligence and the word is overwhelming from people in their circles when they spend money to go hire somebody to do it, to investigate this, that says there's not going to be any criminal charges. This will be all, it'll be settled out of court. If they hear that, I would imagine you'll see teams move on it then. The only thing is the reluctance is what's going to happen legal. Once they get a great feel that it's overwhelmingly to them that we can go do this, even if it's not cleared publicly, mm-hmm. you'll start to see them creep in towards let's get this done, because you don't want to get left out, because somebody's going to go get him, whether it's Carolina or Denver or somebody else. But I imagine that his lawyers, with all that, these high-powered lawyers, are trying to push to find out how we can get it done for that. And I'm sure the Texans want it done. But the Texans, while everybody thinks the Texans don't hold the cards because Watson has no trade clause, he doesn't hold the cards. There's not a lot of options, because if one team wants him and offers 3-1s, like we've said, he has no choice but to take it unless he wants to sit his ass out and not make $40 million bucks or $38 million or whatever it is. So I'm going to say by draft time, Deshaun Watson's in another uniform. Somebody will be desperate yep. as that day creeps up. And remember, this isn't a strong quarterback draft.
No, it's not.
So for other teams that want a starter, they're going to we ain't finding a program or a franchise changer in the draft, at least it appears. But that guy in Houston, if he's cleared for the legal stuff and he's ready to roll, that's a franchise changer. He's that good. So I'm going to say it is going to be cleared by then. But the truth is the Texans can sit back and say, we got nowhere to go. Davis Mills proved he can play a little, got our coach in line. If Watson decides he doesn't want to get traded or somebody doesn't come up, we're not coming off our mark, which is 3 first rounders. Unless you make us an offer we can't refuse with 2 other picks and 2 other players and then 2 first-rounders, whatever it is, it'll be a haul. And until you call me on the phone and I answer, I don't have to do anything, because we're not going to be very good next year regardless. So what's the rush? If Watson wants to, if he pushes it to the side or somebody doesn't want it off, I ain't trading him for a 1 and a 3. But I'm going to say the desperation towards the draft time starts to click in, and by the time that draft is here, Deshaun, I don't know if he'll be cleared, but I do believe Deshaun Watson.
Why would you not trade him for a 1 and 3 if you know he's never going to play for you?
Because they know they don't have to.
But if he's never going to play for you, at what point do you go, I have to move him?
When they go offer you 2 first rounders, 2 seconds, and a third, instead of 3 first rounders, 2 seconds, and a third, and you just want to finally clear house. Because they know right now, looking around the landscape of the league, the desperation with quarterback situation, they don't have to. Because if he doesn't show up and play for the Texans, if they don't want him to play, they don't, then he gets to sit out. And if he doesn't come to camp, he doesn't get paid. He's not getting paid this year. If he doesn't show up, he gets fined every day.
But if he does show up and you're not going to play him, what good is that doing your team?
Because 5 years from now, they can still get a 1 and a 2. Right now, they're sitting there saying, I can get a 1 and a 2. If they offered Watson right now to a team under the current legal circumstances and said, here, Carolina, just give us a number 1 and a number 2. Carolina trade for him right now without even batting an eye over what the legal stuff was. Right. They'd look at each other saying, hell, that's worth the risk.
Yep.
If he doesn't play for a year or he's up, then we get him when he's 27 years old. Okay. Yes. So I hold out. I'm not buying low. This isn't like in business school, you buy low, sell high. I ain't buying. We bought him high and paid him all that money. I ain't selling low. The guy's too good. So I don't have to move on this.
All right. I want to talk to you about 2 teams, and I want to put you in the front office. If you were in the front, and by the way, I'm putting you in the front office of 2 teams that are pretty good. Okay. One was the number 1 seed and another one just missed the playoffs. So you're the general manager of the Titans. You're the general manager of the Colts. And I'm saying to you, all right, your quarterback's Ryan Tannehill and your quarterback's Carson Wentz. You're the GM. Are you keeping those guys? Do you feel that with a good team, they're good enough to get you where you want to go, which obviously is the Super Bowl, or are you going in a different direction?
I've seen enough to know right now that I'm not sure that, and I think Ryan Tannehill's a good player.
Right.
Ryan Tannehill can't carry you through a playoffs without Derrick Henry or a good roster around him. Good player. He's proven he can get me to a point.
Right.
But if the point's to get to January, keep Tannehill. If the point's to get to February, you probably – if there's a better – now, Grant, I always say this. If you like somebody but you love a guy that's out there and you think you can get him, go after the guy you love. You just do it. No, sorry, Tannehill. If all of a sudden Aaron Rodgers is available for a first and a second-round pick and we can get him, I hate to tell you, buddy, and they'll take you with the trade to Green Bay, then you've got to go. I mean, and that because we love him. If you got two guys that you like and you feel it's a lateral move, Tannehill's been pretty committed to you and has done a nice job. Keep him. The other side of it is, and Carson Wentz, I detect that there's, I don't know, there just feels to me Carson Wentz has got more ability than Tannehill. But there's something, there's something missing from when Chris Ballard, when he talked in the past tense about Wentz after the season was over, like, we thought the move was a good move then.
Yep.
It's like, oh, my gosh. Something – Carson Wentz will never be a top five player in this league again.
No.
At his position.
No.
Tannehill never been a top five player at his position. If I could get Watson, which he's not going into the division, so bold, well, that's out. If I could get – listen – okay, let's say 49ers wanted to trade Garoppolo and Tennessee offered or Colts offered a second-round pick.
I was just going to ask you that.
Take him because he knows how to win. He's been in a Super Bowl. I would trade. He's more efficient than either one. He may not be more talented than Wentz.
Right.
He may not be as, you know, in the system there. And that's a semi-lateral move, right? But a guy who's, quite frankly, been to an NFC Championship game and a Super Bowl two out of the last 3 years. Even though he's got a good team. Somebody's still got to take those snaps, right, under center.
And if Joe Montana –
that's exactly right. So, for me, if Rodgers or Wilson were available for the right price and you could move one of them or even a possible Garoppolo, Watson in another division – if I'm the Saints or the Broncos or somebody, I'm all over it. I'm all over it. I'm trying to get him as long as it doesn't mortgage my franchise to the point that by giving up three number ones, it's not going to matter if he's there because we're going to suck anyway. If you've
right.
got a good group – and you can afford, like the Rams,
right.
to get rid of an asset or two first rounders and bring in a quarterback that is gets you over the top, and Stafford proved he could, then you do it. Listen, I'm always for that high school kid at the dance, right, who got his braces off. And the senior, he's at the dance as a sophomore. The senior walks in, and your girl's got her braces on. You're not real sure what she's going to look like in 3 years. I'm being a little – and then the girl that everybody in school loves – and she comes over and starts dancing with you, and she's the hot, you know, the senior that everybody wants to take to the prom. Well, take her to the prom. Makes sense? And then if it works out for 2 years, then go back and visit the young one when she gets her braces off and the headgear 3 years later, right? But you get my point, right? We've all been there, right? It's like, gosh, I got this girl. But man, the senior, she's a little older, a little – could I just have a dance with her to like, okay, cool, I got it. All my buddies are over in the corner. And then – okay, then the girl gets her headgear off and they're from the and it's 3 years. She's now.
You're killing me, dude.
It's true. Tell me you had to go to school with a girl with a headgear and you said, oh my gosh. And then by the time you were a freshman in college, she's like, what? So, and I mean it respect. You get my point, right? The dance.
Right.
Everybody's got their, well, general managers do it all the time. Oh, they're looking over your shoulder, who the next, or movie actor. They're always looking over the shoulder, who's the next one, right?
Right.
If you can get Rodgers, you do it. You do it, but I sense Tannehill stays, Carson Wentz is gone. That's my opinion.
We're on No Filter Network, so you can say shit like that. Now, I don't know if you could just, you know, give that analogy on your radio show. Without.
Why not? You know, I didn't rip anybody. I didn't say make. I said simply a dance, and the girl with braces headgear, that's evidence and fact.
You know damn well someone's going to call up and bitch and complain on your radio station. Here it's no.
Well, guess what? Here's the fucking phone number.
I told you what Jack Youngblood did with me on TV once, right?
No.
Jack and I did the Canadian Football League for 2 years. First ever game in Sacramento. Sacramento, believe it or not, was in the Canadian Football League for 2 years. So the first game is against Doug Flutie and the Calgary Stampeders. It's in Sacramento. It's fucking like 105 degrees for a 6 o'clock kickoff in July. And the Sac State Choir was on the field singing the national anthem. The guys were in black tuxes and the gals were in long green gowns. So we come back from commercial break. Grant Napier, Jack Youngblood, and Jack goes, "Man, is it hot up here?" I go, "Well, Jack, it could have been worse. You could have been on the field in a black tux singing the national anthem." And he says, "Grant, I'm up here sweating like a fat girl." Okay? On TV. "Grant, I'm up here sweating like a fat girl." And I'm no, but you know Blood. You know, listen. Now listen to me, Sean. I pause for like 2 seconds and I go, "Folks, that's Youngblood with a Y." And I just go on with
right.
And meanwhile, I'm trying not to piss my pants, okay, from that comment, you know?
Okay, but you know what? If you said it's a fat guy, sweat like a fat guy, it'd be okay. And it's crazy. And nobody means something. We're not fat shaming anybody. I'm not, well, I'm kind of shaming the person with the braces headgear, kind of, because look, put it this way, if those braces headgear, we can't laugh at them, then why don't they have them anymore? Why don't I ever see anybody? Because why? Because they sucked and nobody wanted to wear them, and now they got better dentists doing, orthodontists doing better stuff, so we don't have to wear the headgear. Point is, it was just a simple dance. And if somebody's uptight about any of that stuff, guess what?
Hey, get a life.
The bottom line is, if in fact, the hotter dance partner walks in on Dancing with the Stars.
Yep.
Get to the hotter partner and move on so you can have a chance to win a championship in the course of a quarterback. Period.
What I'm saying, though, we're on No Filter Network. No one gives a shit. We can do whatever
we want. What are they going to do? Take the fucking scholarship? That's already happened. Okay.
All right. Hey, isn't it interesting that James Harden leaves Brooklyn? They are ultra competitive in their first game down in Miami. Then last night they beat the Kings 110-85. But I'm hearing comments coming out of the Brooklyn locker room talking about how everybody's together and how much better it is and how the guys really like each other now. They got rid of a major problem. Philadelphia has no fucking idea what they're about ready to get into here.
And didn't Harden just back out of the All-Star game? Was that hammy hurt a little bit?
Oh my God. Yeah, so he can be at a strip club somewhere.
Yeah, strip club lap dance, get to him a little bit, get a lappy, and it hurts the hammy.
Would you rather be in Cleveland for a February weekend, or would you rather be in Vegas or somewhere at a strip club? You know what I mean? Come on now.
Well, that's called analytics, brother. Strip club it is.
Analytics.
Listen. When you're not guessing at these things, not you, but any of us, when you see stuff that points to it, like if a guy completes 59% of his passes for 9 years in a row, that's called evidence. He's not accurate. If a guy's a great offensive player but doesn't make anybody better and somehow, some way, late in championship moments, semi-disappears, doesn't mean he's a bad player. Doesn't mean he can't score 30 a game. Doesn't mean he's not an MVP guy. He ain't winning a championship. There ain't nothing wrong with that. I mean, listen, and – if the player you want to know when you find out how the real feeling about a player, listen to the dudes in the locker rooms or in the clubhouses in baseball. They will tell you with their actions and with their, "Hey, do you miss Harden?" And they smirk or smile or they don't say anything or any other player like that. And sometimes one team's trash is another team's treasure. So he may go there and they may love him for a minute and they may not. But listen, there's evidence that says along the way, James has burned a few teams along the way.
Yes.
And he's going to be wearing as many rings as I am. Well, I got great NBA championship rings as I am when this is all said and done. And he'll test your patience. Great talent. Here's the sad thing. When you say this, people say, "What do you do? You don't know anything about basketball." Yes, I do know plenty about basketball. Great talent, a very bad team underachiever.
Yes.
Hall of Famer, he's going, no doubt. But he's going in that Hall of Fame like some others that were actually more team guys than him but never got one.
Yep.
Without that ring on his finger.
I'll tell you this.
Bottom line.
You know, we keep on saying if Durant is healthy and Irving's allowed to play in the home games and Ben Simmons is on the floor, I would not want to have to play that team in a playoff series, because we talked about this. Simmons is going to take away your best offensive player, and then you have to have guys that can play and contain Irving and Durant. And I don't know who in the East that would be.
Agreed. And here's this too. Is Grant, think about this. Seth Curry goes out and bangs to that spacer, hits 23 last night.
Yep.
Was it last night or the night before?
Last night against Sacramento.
Last night, 23, right. He knocks out his 23 and knocking down shots, so comfortability. And you know what, too, is so imperative for the Brooklyn Nets is, you know, all the stuff that surrounded Ben Simmons, and rightfully so, in Philly. Yep. A headache, and can you have – Philly didn't want the migraine, so they decided to go get another migraine and bring him in. And but who's a better offensive player, at least a shooter and scorer? Simmons is a better perimeter defender and pretty good facilitator. Although James can pass, Simmons can as well. Right. But for Brooklyn and the players on that team to bring Simmons in without – I know everybody gets preconceived notions, but let him come in and let's see how he fits with us. Is Ben Simmons – does he fit in with us? I don't ever like to judge a book by like, okay, he was a pain in the ass somewhere else. Like, for instance, Odell Beckham. We heard that pain in the ass. He comes to L.A., and all of a sudden he's a star, a hero, fits right in. And people have those questions now. Will it be that way 4 years down the road? And a speedy recovery and best wishes to him, because I think as a free agent, he'll re-sign with them, and he'll get back late in the season next year with a possible playoff run. So good for him. So he went from that to the Rams. We embraced him, and it will, and it's gone well. So it doesn't have to be everybody's team, but for the Brooklyn Nets to say, okay, let's see what Ben's got and welcome him in and see if he gets – okay, let me at least get back to playing some basketball. And you're right. Spacers, Drummond, if Curry can knock it down, healthy KD, depending on Kyrie Irving. Now you're talking – now Milwaukee, take notice. It's different. Now they're different because KD can take on anybody, and he's a pretty damn good defender himself because he's long and can guard as well. And we know what he is on the offensive end, and he's got balls. So I'm with you, Grant. I know on the surface with the talent, everybody thinks Philadelphia won it, and they did. James is more talented than anybody they got. But when it comes to the overall team picture, I don't think Philadelphia – I mean, I don't think Brooklyn lost this trade. I don't.
No, they did not.
Yep.
Hey, you're on a station in Houston that carries the Astros. They're still going to be one of the favorites. They're really good. We know that. The lockout does not seem like it's close to ending, and I know that we just got done with football. Do you get any – talk about that on your show, or is it a non-story right now? No one gives a shit because
Grant, you'd be shocked. The lockout in baseball is a bigger story in our town than the Super Bowl.
Wow.
People, really? Yeah, the Super Bowl was fine. I mean, we spent an hour talking about it. I brought it up today.
Really?
Looking at Rob Manfred, the lockout. They don't even have another friggin' meeting scheduled.
It's a fucking embarrassment. No,
it is.
It's a joke.
I don't friggin' get it. The last thing these guys need is need McGuire and Sosa to come out of retirement, hit 70 home runs, and save their ass again by let's say they start in May. We're at February 15th.
Yep.
Pitchers and catchers were supposed to report today. So you keep pushing this back, then all of a sudden, and you can't speed up spring training. Why? You ain't going to worry. You're not going to throw Jacob DeGrom out there with two less weeks of spring training to worry about blowing out his rotator cuff or a doggone having Tommy John, right? So you're going to make sure that you get through it. So if that starts games late and you get 148-game season, yeah, it's short, 14 games. But it's still not a good look for baseball. They've known all this time to get here. The thing that chaps my – I know negotiations with Tony Clark and Rob Manfred, they go back. But, Grant, okay, let's just say that you're negotiating for a player, free agent. You want to get him or keep him before camp starts. Aren't you sitting at the table – where your eyes are getting tired, you take 2 hour rest and get your ass back to the negotiating table. What? Why all the time in between? Okay, Rob Manfred, what the fuck is he got to do during the day if it isn't get this done? I understand you got to be a family man. I'm not saying it's all his fault. He bothers me a little bit. I don't know if real. I actually don't think Rob Manfred's a big baseball guy, and I think you got to love baseball. That doesn't mean he's not decent in some areas at his job, but I don't think he's a great commissioner. But
no, he's not.
I'm putting myself in there. If I'm the commissioner, I don't care. Don't give me the well, mine hangs down farther than yours. That's not the case here. Winning negotiations and getting back on the field is not beating somebody over the head with a sledgehammer. It's both of you feeling like you won. And the only way you can negotiate is get your ass in front of each other.
Hey, I know. I mean, it's unbelievable. And again, the people that are getting fucked here are the restaurateurs, the bar owners in all these small towns in Florida and Phoenix, all the parking attendants, all the ushers, all the concessionaires, all the little guy once again is getting fucked. To me, and I said this on my podcast last week, baseball is so tone deaf to what's going on in our society right now. They are completely not dealing with reality. They're all walking around with fucking blinders on, you know, thinking that here we are, billionaires and millionaires can't come to an agreement. And they have, they're totally tone deaf to what's going on in our country.
And the fans don't have a seat at the table. I mean, I'm including the fans is the guys we're talking about. They require that second job to pay that bill, right? Mm-hmm. But I can tell you this, players, no disrespect. I'm usually on the player side in these things. But no player in any union meeting I've ever been in my life in my 10 years of playing professional football. Did we worry about the college freshman who was going to be playing baseball later on or the high school senior or football in our case playing? Never once did we talk about, yeah, but what are we going to do for the guys that come after us 15? Nobody gives a fuck. They don't. And they don't even worry about what they're going to be doing 15 years from now, like insurance, benefits. Right. They care about in that window that I'm playing, how much do I get paid? When am I a free agent? And what are my benefits?
Right.
And until they're out of it for 10 years and they spend it all, then you look back saying, shit, I should have fought for something different. But regardless, I take the player's side. Okay, so we can't get it done. But Grant, why every second that clips by and clicks by, why, if I put myself in Manfred's shoes, and Tony Clark's shoes, and I'll say Rob Manfred. The second one meeting's over, I said, dude, before we leave this meeting, it needs to be on the books. We can schedule the next one. And we shouldn't be leaving town, whoever flies in. I know you got to see your families. But, you know, just like you do to players, hey, we're going away to camp, your families, we only get to see them once a week. Guess what your ass has got to do? Sit at the table, keep hammering it out so we get started on time. Because it tells me that it's so nonchalant. Oh, we'll wait till they – what's the counter proposal? Why aren't you ahead of this? Knowing what you anticipate they're going to bring back to you. I can't get the grown men and women to sit at a table and get it done. So we talk about it a lot on my show because Houston is a – Texas is a football state, Grant.
Yeah.
Houston is a baseball town. They don't trust the Texans. The Rockets aren't good right now. We carry them to – put it this way. Over the last 3 months, we've talked – 1,000 more times the lockout than we have Rockets basketball.
No shit.
They're playing the regular season.
Wow.
And that, I mean, love Steve and Sine. I understand they got to win.
Yeah.
But it's just reality. It's reality. It doesn't move any. I mean, right now when you're not playing well, those things have trouble moving the needle. What moves the needle is now people, now Astros fans and baseball fans, after about a week of this, they're going to be getting restless because they're thinking about planning their spring training trip. And get ready to start the season on time like we all do, and rightfully so. And unfortunately, as you mentioned it, the people who always talk about taking a sledgehammer to the head, and those fans, guess what they're going to do? You're going to pay the same price in every city, and then it's going to get hiked up. They're not going to say, you know what, thanks for being a great fan. Let's drop that hot dog in half, seven, all, not just dollar dog night. Well, you're going to play dollar dogs all year long in all the ballparks. You're going to buy – your beers are going to be $2.50. Sure they are. So the fans and those people you're talking about that rely on it – and I know the players want to play, and I know the owners want to play, but – you know what? The only way you can get it done is if your ass sits there and negotiates. Like, not like an 8-year-old child that take your ball and go home. Schedule the meetings. Why are we waiting? Schedule them. We are February fucking 15th.
Yep.
Pitchers and catchers should be out in Scottsdale and Sarasota, Florida, and all those other places. Damn, warming up and doing Winter Haven and doing all the shit they do. Right.
It's a joke. I mean, you know, even if they came up with a deal this week, you know, you got to ratify it. Then you got to, I mean, it's still, everything is going to be fucking delayed now. It's just a joke. It really is. You know, you surprised me by what you just said of all the talk that goes on in Houston. And again, I only go to Houston when I was doing the Kings and the Rockets. So I didn't spend a lot of time there. I obviously have known about their infatuation with baseball there when it's not football season. But I that surprises me what you just said. I didn't expect there would be that much talk.
Here's the talk. When's Watson getting traded, or why? There's still people. Why aren't we keeping him? You get that? Look, head coaching thing with when David Culley left. Who's going to be the coach? Was talk dominates because football season. Then you mix in some other stuff. Where you know is Rodgers the MVP, and who's going to win a Super Bowl? And then it goes after that. It's Astros. What Carlos Correa has been talked about more this fall than quite frankly, Grant, Watson and Correa,
I can see that.
Week 10, when the Texans are 2-4, people would rather talk Carlos Correa's contract, waiting to see if he ends up in Boston and New York and Los Angeles or somewhere else. Is now that football season's over, their mind shifts to two things: Correa, Watson.
Yep.
And probably in that order, to be honest with you, Grant, even though they know unequivocally for the most part, but they're hanging on a thread, that both of them are gone. That for one reason, Watson's getting traded. And Mr. Crane, who I love, Jim Crane's a phenomenal owner, is not going to pay him $330 million for 10 years, or they already would have. You wouldn't let him touch him. So he's going to go get his money somewhere else. He's not coming. And we know for the most part in this town that both of them are leaving for different reasons.
Yep.
And yet still the talk and the Correa stuff now is going to ramp up as we start to hear the whispers now. But until the lockout's over, that's all it's going to be is whispers, because you can't sign. So there you have it.
All right, buddy. You have a good rest of the day, all right? Keep those fucking
talks. We're already done. Damn, what a fast. Look at you get me all riled up. Hey, look at this right here. See this being for Boston Red Sox? Take a look, brother. Number one. We're number one.
I thought that.
And by the way,
I thought that was a Barcelona shirt. The Barcelona
it should be. Hey, they're at least they're playing soccer or something, right? Hey, by the way, you were the guy. You wore the fucking headset, didn't you, in school? Were you the uncool guy that had the braces headset? That was you, wasn't it?
You know what? I never had braces.
Me either. Never had my wisdom teeth pulled either. You didn't either?
No.
No wonder our mouths are so big, because our wisdom teeth fit in there, right? But were you the cool guy in high school, real quick? Were you like the cool guy there? Everybody like, oh, that's Grant Napier. He's the shit.
I was popular. I don't know if I was cool, but
So basically, you're telling me when you went to that, you were the hot guy that walked in that all the girls said, I got to have Napier.
That definitely was not the fucking case. You know what? Honestly, in high school, I was so into playing sports. I was so into playing football and lacrosse. I was a really good lacrosse player. Got a scholarship to go to college. That my focus in high school was only sports.
Sports and academics for me. Yeah, the same thing. I'm dead serious. I'm telling you right now. People look at me and I got the college saying, you a lying son of a bitch. No, it's true. Listen, I didn't know the difference between a French manicure and a French kiss when I was a sophomore. But I can dunk on your ass, okay?
Hey, I'm the same way, man. Hey.
I'm like, I'm dancing slow. I'm like, man, true story now. I got to end with this. I know it's taking longer. Does it cut us off in like a minute?
No, we could go.
I'm like freshman. They have like the king, queen, prince, the homecoming. And so I'm freshman prince, dude. I don't have a clue. So you got to kiss the girl. And the gal I kissed was a little more mature than I was. Let's just put it that way. So when you walk through the veil, when they introduce you, hey, freshman prince and princess, Sean Salisbury, and I'll leave her name out, great girl, but comes walking up, you got to stop at the thing and kiss them before you walk down the red carpet. But, dude, I go leading up to it. I'm talking to my mom. I said, a couple of my buddies said, what happens if she puts her tongue in my mouth? What do I do? I was so friggin' clueless, and that's a true story. So I was scared to death. I didn't care about anything else. I had the tux on and the rest of it, because freshman plays on Thursday, varsity on Friday. I'm walking down there, and the only thing I could think of for a month, it screwed me up in taking tests in school, because I'm thinking, I'm going to fuck this up, and I'm going to be the laughingstock. And so I kind of gave her a peck and kind of got Sam a little bit of time. I didn't know what I was doing. Then I took her to the dance the next night. My old man had to drop me off when we left. I walk up to the door, and I'm like, just got a peck and I leave, and I'm like, thanks, Dad. I had no clue. I had no frigging clue, right? So there you have it. All big talk now, but you know what? You might as well have put headgear braces on, because that's about how much pull I had as a freshman in high school. There you go.
You're a fucking beauty. Braces. You know that?
Yep. I still don't know how to French kiss, but man, there you go. And I do know what Rick Baker is.
On that note, we'll say goodbye.
Definitely will. Hey, by the way, it's hotter than us. What did Youngblood say? Oh, I love you, brother. Thank you.
I love you too. We'll see you Thursday.
All right, man. Thanks.